Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Call is Coming from Inside the House. Essays by Allyson McOuat. Narrated by me, the author, Allyson McOuat. Dedication. In memory of my mother, Lila Ann Holland, who would want me to tell you that I can also sing and dance, and for my daughters, Tatum and Georgia, who make me want to sing and dance. Quotes. Vanity Fair. What do you regard as the lowest depth of misery? David Bowie. Living in fear. I'm not interested in everyday reality, but in the reality of the heart. I like fantasy, like a fairy tale. I'm interested in shadows and contrasts. Gene Wilder. The playlist. I've included a suggested playlist for you to listen to as you read along with the essays. Prologue, Into the Woods. Goodbye Horses by Q. Lazarus. A Forest by The Cure. The Harbinger. Escape Myself by Nouvelle Vague. Looking for Clues by Robert Palmer. The Haunted House. The House That We Built by Alicia's Attic. The Haunted, You're the One That I Want, by Lo Fang. The Storyteller, Stand By Me, by Tracy Chapman. The Teenage Girls, Freedom, 90, by George Michael. The Pregnant Woman, Three Babies, by Sinead O'Connor. The Fortune Teller, Crossbone Style, by Cat Powers. The Crone, The Maiden, and the Raccoon, Regret, by New Order. Female of the Species by Space. The Bitch. Bridges by Destiny's Child. The Man at the End of the Bed. Bad Dream by Cannons. The Babysitter. This City Never Sleeps by Eurythmics. Boys Wanna Be Her by Peaches. The Psycho Chick. Human Behavior by Bjork. The Victim, I Will Survive by Cake. Rising by Lassa de Sella. The Coven, Magic by Olivia Newton-John. Epilogue, Love is Digging the Grave, Without You, Without Them by Boy Genius. Bonus, Video Verite by Blue Peter. Prologue, Into the Woods We Go. Into the woods and through the fear, you have to take the journey. Stephen Sondheim. A spring ambles across the back of my parents' property, right between their home and the adjacent 27-acre forest. I haven't lived here for over two decades, choosing instead to raise my family in Toronto. For a long time, I considered myself an urban person rather than a suburban one. Falling for another useless form of binary determinism that you must always be one thing or another. But now that I'm nearing the end of my 40s, I see that I exist on the sub/urban spectrum. It's true that even a distance as relatively small as 40 kilometers can seem like a different world, but I love this creek, this house, this neighborhood. The time of my life spent growing up in the suburbs, especially from 1980 to 2000, shaped me into the queer woman I am today, and the city gave me a safe place to live that life. I grew up with many privileges in a two-parent home that was one of thousands of contemporary two-parent cookie-cutter households like it. Our home held delightful secrets in the backyard. A path through wild gardens with wonderland-like flowers the size of dinner plates that led to a grass-covered hill down to the stream, all enclosed in a shaded glen with the towering trees of a forest all around. Sheltered twice over, as the suburbs in general were heavily protected from any perceived negative influences from alternative culture. We had a wide selection of mainstream films shown at our local theater and available for rent at the corner Blockbuster. The local HMV carried chart-topping records and songs from the British invasion of the 1990s, but not much else. I was discouraged from watching anything in the horror genre because it wasn't ladylike. Like most families in the suburbs in the 1980s, ours followed the trends. Little girls took skating and dance classes, and little boys played hockey and soccer. Little boys could watch Friday the 13th, and little girls could watch Anne of Green Gables. It kept things simple. But I was drawn to complexities, so whenever I would come across something subversive or outstandingly baroque, like Orlando, the amorphous Tilda Swinton starring film adaptation of Virginia Woolf's work, I would yearn for more. Despite its limitations, the spot I grew up in now feels like a magical, restorative land to me, and I'm not alone in that assessment. For 10,000 years, indigenous groups like the Huron-Wendat, Haudenosaunee, and Anishinaabe called this area home before the original British invasion. In 1805, the land was included in the Toronto Purchase as Treaty 13, and by the late 1800s, Spring Creek, as it was called, was considered something of a fountain of youth. Drinking from it was said to give long life. A local hotel, long since shuttered, once described the creek in their advertising as, "Embowed in a sylvan grove, its spring water is far famed for its miraculous cures." The stream became an attraction that made our small town a destination for health-conscious tourists. I never tire of exploring this forest and stream because, as it is with life, your view changes dramatically with every season. In the winter, the forest is gray and quiet, and some mornings you can spy the 7 local deer walking through the brush. In the summer, the woods are verdant and noisy with the call of birds and chatter of squirrels. The spring is sometimes frightening because the riverbanks often flood and threaten to rise up to the back door. My father calls it the storybook house because everything in the antique-filled house, from the brass doorknobs to the cutlery, holds a story. And I guess now this book, about the subversive, dangerous, and supernatural stories that shape me, will be part of the storybook house, too. Every day, there's another story to tell. Although as a mother and cis femme queer woman, I've struggled with centering my stories and experiences, separating the expectations of my role from my individual being, and as they say in Orlando, not drowning anonymously in the milk of female kindness. We must stay sweet, calm, and sheltered. On a recent autumn evening, an ex-lover and I were visiting with my parents and decided to walk my 2-year-old English bulldog pandemic puppy. We strolled down the main road from home, hand in hand, and stopped in a suburban playground that was on the edge of our forest to take in the bright stars and the full moon. It was exactly the kind of late autumn atmosphere that makes for either a romance movie or a horror film. A gentle breeze blowing a smattering of leaves off the trees, a crisp temperature, a layer of fog-like mist in the air. Although, romance and horror are sometimes linked for me. I always feel scared when I think about trying to fall in love again with some new person, a stranger. The time it takes to get to know someone intimately. The risks. I've had some heartbreaks that were so painful they took years to recover from. She was one of them. We paused on the edge of the unlit soccer field to look up at the night sky and explore the constellations via a handy app on her phone. We were delighted at how the app instantaneously displayed both the bright stars we could clearly see right in front of us, with the added bonus of including those stars that were too far in the distance to discern or were covered by clouds. An animated line on her screen bounced from one invisible star millions of miles away from us to another, connecting them all into a picture of a bear. Eons of myth, complicated scientific measurements, distant satellites, detailed coding, stories told around ancient campfires, and cutting-edge communications technology collided in this one godlike app that we tiny mortals could now access with the touch of a finger. It was amazing, but at the same time, I was experiencing an uncomfortable sensation of vulnerability, not dissimilar to something called thalassophobia, a reverse kind of claustrophobia that I'd experienced only once before while snorkeling in the ocean, a realization that the water has no walls or doors, It was wide open all around me for miles, and I was sharing this incomprehensibly enormous space with billions of sea creatures. Sharks, giant blue whales, eels and barracuda, clownfish and octopi. I was completely exposed and as tiny and irrelevant to this whole ecosystem as the shell on one single hermit crab out of tens of millions in the ocean, easily discarded when my usefulness to the environment was complete. Oh, and also, she chimed, shaking her short white curls in excitement as she looked down at the grass and dirt below us, I can show you the stars on the other side of the world right now, as if we were looking right through the center of the earth and coming out the other side. Great, I said. As she turned her screen down towards the ground, my dog, silent but agitated, strained against her red leather collar in the direction of the forest. She seemed desperate to explore, her wrinkled nose furiously sniffing the air. As she lunged, her leash tangled around the legs of my friend, pulling me into her leather jacket. Our legs wound together just like in the beginning of 101 Dalmatians, my gray high-heeled boots against her jeans. We rolled our eyes and scoffed at the Hallmarkian accuracy of the dog's timing as we untangled each other from our constraints. It's been obvious to everyone around us that something still existed in the space between her and me. They wanted answers as to why we weren't together anymore. The truth was that we simply weren't compatible in ways we considered too private to discuss publicly, so instead, we don't talk about it at all. As I bent down to unleash the dog, I paused and followed my pup's gaze. That's when I saw movement in the dark. It explained why she was so agitated. She knew something was there. A spectral form slowly moving alongside us. Mesmerized as the shape emerged out of the shadows, I tried to adjust my eyes to see what I was looking at. A small deer? No, definitely a dog. But black as pitch, it was positively ghostly. I even thought for a millisecond that I could see right through the animal to the trees behind. The closer it came, the clearer it became. It was a wolf-like creature. Its back and head were planked, its ears laid down tight to its head. It was stalking us. My friend quietly told me to walk slowly out of the park, backwards. And as we did, she gallantly stepped between me and the beast. My dog bounded excitedly along beside me. I felt ridiculous, but I did as she instructed and slowly and steadily tiptoed my way backwards up the path and out of the park, while trying to keep an eye on the animal. The coyote slipped back into complete concealment and disappeared, leaving no trace. Despite growing up right next to these woods, I realized then that I knew very little of its spirit. This whole time, I'd been childishly romanticizing the trees, when all the while I'd been looking out over a forest full of impossibly beautiful dangers. Comforted by the bright street lamps of the main roadway, we paused for a deep breath before continuing on, nervously laughing about how close we'd come to danger without knowing. As we walked down the road back towards my parents' home, we talked about other people who'd been in similar situations and how they'd handled it. We recalled articles and advice we'd read about facing down wildlife, TikToks and YouTube videos. Should it come back again, my friend suggested that we run for the nearest house and knock on the door. I said I wouldn't disturb one of my neighbors this late unless I was pursued by Michael Myers and he was on an electric scooter. I haphazardly darted a quick look backwards just to make sure the coyote hadn't followed us out onto the street. And sure enough, there he was. Only 20 feet behind us, having left the safety of the forest and loping brazenly down the middle of the roadway in full evening street light. Now that I could really see him, I confirmed that the animal was larger than any coyote I'd ever seen. He was huge and black and fluffy like a wolf. My, what big ears he had, long and now perked up, listening intently. And my, what big eyes he had, black and steady and locked on us. And my, what long legs he had, as he switched from a trot into a full-blown sprint towards us. We shrieked with fear and took off running, she in sensible sneakers and I in my trademark inappropriate footwear, the dog looking at me as if to say, "Now you run? I told you to run 10 minutes ago." We all ran together down the entire length of the street towards my parents' house, and honestly, the wolf must not have been putting his all behind it because we beat him to the door and we are not sprinters. Of course, I scrambled at the door to find my keys, dropping them and picking them back up again in another cliche of a horror film. On seeing that we were as good as inside, the animal stopped his pursuit and loped away down another street instead. Afterwards, laughing and breathlessly recounting this story to family inside and via group FaceTimes, we were first dismissed. A wolf? In the suburbs? You lie. But once they believed us, the interrogation began. How big was it really? I thought you said you couldn't see it. Are you sure it wasn't a German shepherd? Did it really chase you, or was it just running in the same direction? Do you really think it was trying to kill you? And then finally, the blaming. Well, what were you doing walking your dog at night and near a forest? Oh my God, I would never do that. Look, you really need to be more careful. I didn't know how to answer their skepticism and judgment. Yes, there was a large wolf-like animal that was following us. And yes, it ran down the street towards us. But I don't know what was going on in the creature's mind. I didn't stop to psychoanalyze it like a bespectacled roadrunner plunking Wile E. Coyote down on a couch and pulling out a notepad. I don't know if the animal planned to grab my chubby little dog by the scruff and take off with her, or if he was going to attack one of us, or if he was simply out stretching his legs a bit on a cool fall evening and enjoyed making middle-aged women squeal and run away like chickens. What good did questioning our story do? I felt I'd done my due diligence. I informed them all of the threat in the neighborhood. There's a beast in the forest. I've accomplished that in an easily digestible way by entertaining them with self-deprecating jokes about my inappropriate footwear. I've hopefully made them think twice about forest safety after dark. I've even brought along a witness to corroborate who is known to be beyond reproach. And they still don't believe me. But their believing me doesn't change the fact that it happened. And I'll never be able to make everything clear for them. We ask the impossible of our nonfiction writers. I suppose you must understand before heading any further into this book that, like this story, not every story will be complete or simple or contain 100% God's honest truth for myriad reasons which I will further illuminate throughout. Instead, in the retelling of stories, I will, as we all do, hopscotch from one chalk-drawn, logic-filled square to another, all towards the tossed pebble at the finish. But likely skipping numbers along the way, missing the larger leaps I'm not bold enough to take, approaching only the faintest outline of an answer, the bulk of which has been blown away in the wind. As a Gen Xer who witnessed the rise of home video, cable television, personal computers, and the early stages of the internet, my generation had unprecedented access to movies, music, and literature. It's how we explored different perspectives, challenged conventions, and shaped our own identities. So any story I tell is also inevitably shaped by the media of my time. The stories that resonated with me that often captured the rebellious and independent spirit of my generation addressed themes of alienation, individualism, and skepticism towards authority. And as I'm preparing for this journey solo, any recounting will unfortunately be devoid of the entirety afforded by the varying perspectives of all people involved. Because surely there were conversations I was not privy to, feelings that others were too scared or shy to share, history, prejudices, and belief systems that I could never access, books I haven't read, speeches I haven't heard. My mind alone is available to frame this narrative, using the information and recollections I've gleaned from my own place of privilege, prejudice, and personal experience. And also, my mind is prone to meandering. In other words, this series of stories will be exactly like every other story ever told in the history of humankind. A partial snapshot of a much larger and expansive, infinite landscape, most of which is not visible. That may be unsettling, thalassophobic even, to those who want binary logic and irrefutable clarity. We have to access vulnerability, both when we look at our truth and when we listen to someone else's, because it requires trust. That's why the tension that true stories create is a very frightening thing for many people. Because trust is vulnerability, and vulnerability, it's frightening. Because we've all been told that only terror lies in wait in the places where the invisible reigns. And that's where we have to go to find the truth. How I wish I could tour you around the entirety of my stories and highlight important historical aspects. I dream about saying with concrete confidence that this exact thing happened right here, and this did not. I wish I could be like my friend's Constellation app and save you the frustration of looking for meaning in the chaos and instead highlight all the stars with a laser pointer. But the one thing I know definitively is that the greatest torments I've experienced in my several decades of life grew from the places where the complete picture was denied me. We know how important the truth is. Rule number one of the boy, or in my case woman, who cried wolf is, tell the truth or the townspeople will let you get ripped apart by wolves. Without some tactile, tangible concept of truth that we can ground ourselves to, we risk being left floating about with unsettled spirits. I suppose that's why, as clever pattern makers, when we humans miss the lines between stars, we will draw our own. When we don't have the complete story, we will automatically stretch logic in directions that it wasn't meant to go, and then fall for fallacies instead of exerting the patience we need to wait for confirmation. We form our own conclusions. It's not our fault we're wired this way, particularly women of Generation X, the first to head home after school to the empty house of working parents, parents with more complex personal lives than ever before, with divorce and remarriage rates higher than ever. We were raised on TV, movies, and stories that modified society's new, complex, uncomfortable truths and mixed them up with an amalgamation of ancient and urban myths, generalized threats, and sometimes even a little sprinkle of gore on top to scare children straight. We started out young, being soothed to sleep with fairy tales about half-dead princesses and the witches and hags who cursed them, folk tales about giant trolls hiding under bridges, and then wonder why as adults we all get so anxious at bedtime. Through these stories, we learned how vulnerable we are when our truth gets into the hands of the unscrupulous. Once the wolf knows where you're going, he will run faster than you, right for the cottage, and take whatever's most valuable to you, like your sweet Nana. These stories taught us to constantly question what truths are told to us, because a nightgown on a wolf doesn't make her your Nana, even if she tells you she is. It's still identity theft and probably transphobic. These stories ingrained in us the idea that on our path through life, we will inevitably come close to danger because it's always around us, waiting for the right time to attack. Sometimes it's even right there in your own family. It's no wonder that as we age, we're drawn to adult versions of these same cautionary tales in the form of bloody horror films about unrelenting monsters chasing down women, true crime podcasts about real-life missing women and children, and limited series about grizzled detectives close to retirement wanting to wrap up this one last case. These tales serve a purpose beyond teaching us roundabout lessons and morals. They give us a legitimate, concrete focal point for our overwhelming existential anxieties about what terrors may await us. They answer our questions and give us a clarity we can sink our teeth into. The murkiness of nuance and endless possibilities will always be scarier than the grisliest of solid truths. And then there are other reasons people are afraid of what's hidden in the nuance. For those of us who identify as queer in my generation, we know that there's a phantasmic mix of fear and excitement in what information we choose to hold back. Two emotions which manifest in the exact same physical symptoms, butterflies appearing out of nowhere and rustling about inside your stomach, the hairs on your arms and the back of your neck elevating, breath held. For those of us with fluid queer identities that may for years be lesbian and then for a time be bi or pan, we know what it is to be considered the invisible monster, whispered about as a person without a strong identity, the traitor to the community, a double agent who slips in and out of the culture, letting ourselves be seen and unseen when it's convenient for us. Society has conditioned us to be hypervigilant against anyone who seems to be hiding part of their nature in plain sight. Our true crime-obsessed media is predominantly dedicated to feeding into this fear by trying to deconstruct the psychology behind the killers who walked amongst us, hiding their violent, psychopathic tendencies. Ted Bundy, John Wayne Gacy, Paul Bernardo, and Carla Homolka, Bruce MacArthur, and others. A heartless killer could be standing right there in front of you in their very own skin and be someone completely different from the person you have been utterly convinced they were the whole time. Homophobia fed on this. Others recognized someone with a secret and saw it as dangerous. But it wasn't violence queer people were hiding. It was love. Once someone's true self is uncovered, that truth can be life-altering, terrifying, and dangerous. Or it might be brilliantly, blindingly, wonderfully revealing and celebratory. Either way, we're all better for knowing the truth about each other. Wading through the fog of nuance to reach the clarity of truth might be frightening. But I think I'm still going to go looking for it. Because believing in ourselves, living our own stories, trusting our own experiences and influences, understanding how they shaped us, that's how we develop the unextinguishable light within us, the fire that keeps us warm at night. No one benefits when you let others tell you what to think or how to feel about your own experiences or what you should enjoy. With my coyote, should I have questioned whether to feel frightened? What if I'd taken the time to stop and consider what people would think about my reaction instead of running? Would my pudgy little dog be coyote feed now? Everyone's experience of what they see as a threat and what sparks their own fear is unique to their journey. The only way to really understand another person is to walk the same pathway and witness the monsters they faced deep in the woods. The Harbinger. Death at every corner. Outside gets inside through her skin. I've been out before, but this time it's much safer in. Kate Bush, breathing. Look, I knew it was coming. It was an inevitable torture. All I could do was brace myself for the words as they left her tiny little mouth and the sounds entered the atmosphere. Mommy, we watch Frozen? This would be our 9,756th viewing of the cartoon this week. Her eyes were enormous bright blue magnets searching deep into my soul and attracting my bottomless generosity for her. Frozen is a movie about a young queen embracing her icy inner superpower after her frightened parents are warned by a mystical rock troll that their daughter's magic is powerful and fear would be her enemy. They take the rock troll's words to mean that other people's fear is their daughter's enemy, and they train her to be afraid of herself instead, forcing her to mask for her entire childhood. Many people speculate about Elsa's sexuality. One of the first female Disney characters without an obvious love interest. Elsa has been queer-coded as lesbian, bi, aromantic, or asexual. I like the film. The message is one I want my children to know, that when you embrace what makes you different, instead of being scared by it, your outfits and hairstyle will improve, as will your overall outlook on life. Don't shut out love when it's offered. Set boundaries. Build your own castle, but keep the door open. So I said, yes, sweetheart, and shuffled her and her little sister into the living room and up on the couch to start the sisterly bonding early. Queer coding in film is something that started in the 1930s when the Hays Morality Code was established. Queerness became built into subtext through exaggerated mannerisms, tone of voice, or lisps, bold fashion choices, or occupations. For generations, the more overtly queer the character, the stronger the ultimate punishment for their sins. It's one of the reasons most of the queer-coded characters in Disney films are villains, like Scar, Ursula, and Captain Hook. Elsa is queer-coded almost immediately by Grandpappy, the troll who acts as the Harbinger in Frozen, the mystical rock troll that the girls' parents take them to after Anna has been accidentally zapped in the head with Elsa's magic. Her ability to bend the natural order at her wish is subtext for stepping outside heteronormativity. When the troll asks Elsa's parents if she was born with the powers or cursed, he may as well be asking if queerness is nature or nurture. When he warns Elsa that there is great danger in her power, he's essentially saying that she will face ignorance and bigotry in her lifetime if she uses her powers publicly. And he encourages her to control her power, meaning know when it's safe to show your true self and when you have to mask it for your own safety. But he also gives her some positive messaging, illuminating that there will be great beauty in her power, which there always is when it comes to love. I started to fade out a bit as we listened to the calming strains of the opening song. Apparently, according to Google, the opening song was based on a Sami yoik. A yoik is a unique cultural expression similar to singing, but really, it's more than that. A yoik is more like a spell designed to conjure up those who've been lost and form a living image of them in sound. A yoik neither begins nor ends. It just is. Some yoiks have words, some don't. Some are rhythms or hand gestures. But this one has lyrics, and they are loosely translated too. Times must come, times must roll, family must follow family's path. I was cradling my 2-year-old on my lap when an image of her falling flashed in front of my eyes. I could almost hear the sound her skull made as it thunked against the floor. I winced and rubbed her pajama-clad back, warm and soft, knowing she was safe here, draped across my body. But the image was powerful, like it was all happening again right that second, and not as it had actually happened a long time before, when she was only 3.5 months old. She was lying in the middle of our king-size bed, surrounded by a barricade of folded laundry, and kicking her chubby little feet in the air to grab at them. I remember she captured a pink toe perfectly sized to fit inside her lips, and I felt a little jealous of her flexibility. I wandered back and forth between her and the dresser, slipping some shirts into the second drawer. The afternoon was sunny and bright, and reminiscent of the greatest mid-afternoon nap I had ever stolen, curled up in a sunbeam with my eldest daughter when she was a newborn, like two contented kitties. I turned back towards the bed just in time to witness a momentous milestone. One I hadn't been expecting her to reach until she was another month or two older. Her first role, or rather, in her case, roles. My baby had turned herself all the way over, and instead of stopping there, she must have turned a second time, bypassing the laundry, because she was teetering on the edge of the bed 3 feet from the floor. My fight, flight, freeze, fawn response is always freeze. So it seemed for a moment that we were both suspended in time before launching into the air, her falling towards the hardwood, and me leaping towards her, arms outstretched. My body failed us. My fingers were too short, my form too heavy, my muscles still weak from the C-section and bed rest. I missed catching her by 1/4 inch. We were both silent from shock before her eyes welled with tears and the ear-splitting shrieking began. I raced her to the hospital, and thankfully she was absolutely fine. There was no skull fracture, no concussion, no damage at all, not even a bruise. It was an accident, I had to constantly remind myself. There was no reason to think she might fall. But every now and then, my body stiffens and my mind becomes stuck in that moment. I'll never put my babies in potential danger because I can see it all around me now. Every possible scenario that could cause pain, I have analyzed the second we walk into the room. My now ex-wife used to call my superpower death at every corner. I like to playfully personify it now as my own personal harbinger of doom. The harbinger is the character at the beginning of every horror story that warns the characters of what's about to befall them. The ominous gas station attendant, The oddball townie, like Crazy Ralph in Friday the 13th, who warns the teenagers to stay away from camp blood. The terrified local in a Stephen King short story who runs into the grocery store screaming, "There's something in the mist!" If you're looking for them, you'll usually find the Harbinger somewhere around a rundown old gas station, because their sole purpose is to add fuel to the plotline. Gas us all up so we can get to the scary part a little faster. The Harbinger is glaringly obvious and demands our attention, leaping out of dark corners, cutting the characters off at the pass, sometimes even following them all the way to the scene of the future crime to warn them again. You can't ignore the Harbinger, and yet the lead characters always do. If Michelle Mancini of 1998's Urban Legend had patiently waited for Michael McDonald's stutter to play out so he could finish his sentence, instead of macing him and subsequently nearly running him over with her SUV, she would have heard him yell that there was someone in the back seat and saved herself an axe to the face 2 minutes later. The Harbinger knows the geography. This is their territory. They've been here before, and yet still the main characters brush them off as hysterics. And I understand why. The Harbinger is scary, loud, jarring, comes at you by surprise, is terribly inconvenient to your plans, and sometimes a little drunk. Almost immediately after my ex and I separated, my inner Harbinger started working overtime. I think at first it was a somewhat reasonable byproduct of being the only adult in the house now, responsible for two tiny girls and a blind dog. I was exhausted, down to the marrow of my bones, both sleep-deprived and totally grief-stricken from what seemed to be the sudden loss of my marriage. Add to that a sprinkling of fear from living in a potentially haunted house that came with its own brand of creepy surprises to navigate day and night, and within a few months, my Harbinger was becoming unbearable, demanding my attention with the intensity of an overtired toddler. That night, I lifted my child off me and walked into the kitchen. The children always had to be in the same room as me, even though the house was open concept, so my little shadows followed behind me, practically attached to my feet. One stopped at the pint-sized craft table that their mama had made to fit all baby things neatly and stylishly into the corner, and she picked up some safety scissors to casually clip out 1,000 pieces of scrap paper and scatter them across the floor, one of her favorite pastimes. The sound of the scissors rhythmically snip, snip, snipping was both several feet away from me and right inside my ear at the same time. Snip, 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 snip. I tried not to anticipate the sound, the pause, the second of silence when the scissors stopped cutting because the blades had found the flesh of her thumb instead. But it didn't happen that time. She continued to happily distribute little confetti-sized pieces of pink construction paper all over the floor while I began preparing the evening bottle for my littlest, who had toddled over and tugged on my pant leg. "Uppa! Uppa!" she cried. "No, sweetie. Mummy's doing something," I said, as the clicking of the knob released a stream of gas and a blue flame appeared on the stove. My inner Harbinger jumped out at me to say, "Look out! Fire!" Because gas stoves always make me recall the story that I was told about the time my brother and his friends almost died at a backyard barbecue. Our family friend once threw a dinner party with his then-husband to celebrate redecorating their kitchen. It had been a massive renovation, and their home was absolutely stunning. I've heard some people speculate that our friend had too many martinis, as he would say, and had left the lid down when he lit the grill, letting all of the gas build up under the lid. Others said it was probably a leak in the propane tank. Whatever the reason, when he went to put the shish kebabs on, he touched the barbecue lighter to the pilot, and, according to the witnesses, a massive ball of fire appeared in the air above the grill. Flames blazed out from underneath the barbecue. My friend screamed, "Dive!" and his table full of fabulous guests hurled themselves over the railing of the deck and onto the grass below to avoid the explosion. The new kitchen was completely destroyed. But no one was badly hurt, thank God. And we were safe here today, I told my harbinger. I took a deep breath and continued stirring, warming the milk up with my shadow at my feet, both kids blissfully unaware of the simmering stress happening underneath my calm exterior. Go, sweetie. Go away from the hot stove. I shooed her away to play. I worry that no matter what I do, I'm destined to infuse them with my anxiety. This evening, like every evening, continued on in the same way, with both of my children and the harbinger competing for my attention. By bedtime, my body would inevitably cave to the stress, and I would fall asleep with the girls at 8:30 or 9 p.m., all piled into the same big bed. I initiated a family bed for the three of us immediately upon becoming a single parent, for safety, comfort, and convenience, as my toddler would wake almost hourly from the day she came home from the hospital until after her fifth birthday. In dreams, like Freddy Krueger, my harbinger would continue showing me potential stressors, a memory of some other person's trauma that would bubble up from my subconscious and become my own. The harbinger hollering at me, "You'll get them all killed if you don't listen to me!" I would wake with hard balls of knots under the thin skin of my shoulder blades. But he hasn't always been there.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.